What is going on, Hive Warriors? It's your boy, Edward V, and today we're going to talk about should you even use apple cider vinegar anymore? Let's circle back all the way to this final point on this topic. Let's go ahead and break it down in this video. Stay tuned. Alright guys, quickly before we start, this video is brought to you by my favorite sponsor, Built Bar. That's right, the protein bar that thwarts all protein bar in consistency and definitely in taste. And basically the bang for your buck on this in terms of the protein you get and even fiber that you get in this, you can't beat it. You can't beat it. And I've already explained to you guys how important protein is to your diet. A lot of people don't have as much protein as they need on a daily basis. Up your protein, and there's no easier way to do it than just unwrapping one of these bad boys and eating them. This is my favorite one, cookies and cream, but there are so many to choose from. Give protein the love that they deserve as it provides you the building blocks of muscle and tissue with amino acids. Listen guys, you need your protein. Stop playing around. The link will be down in the description box below. You can type in the promo code FLEDGE10 and you can get 10% off your order. Now, let's go ahead and jump right into the video. Should you drink apple cider vinegar anymore? Now, all of my videos, I always use scientific research. I don't try something, see how I feel, you know, put my finger to the wind and see how that felt, and then say, it's time for me to make a video and let thousands of people know exactly what I did and how, what would that mean to you. I never do that. All of my videos, every single one, over 400 something videos on intermittent fasting, weight loss, fat loss, muscle building, they're all connected to scientific research. And it's connected to the gold standard of scientific research, the hierarchy of what is more than likely the situation versus in terms of human biology, based on things like using meta-analysis or even just using meta-analysis that has randomized controlled trials, the amount of studies that we have, the amount of studies that say the opposite thing to that thing. That's what matters. That full conglomerate, not just one paper, because you can find one paper that says anything. Is the full conglomerate of the studies, the study designs, the methodologies, the meta-analysis, the systematic reviews, all of that put together can give you the most likely scenario when it comes to the human biology. And even with that, it's still the most likely scenario because you always have even non-responsive group within those groups that show that positive outcome for those studies. So should you use apple cider vinegar anymore? My answer to that is no. Now, does using apple cider vinegar really do anything negative towards you if you wanted to keep using it? My answer to that is no. So apple cider vinegar doesn't really create a detriment to you, but it also doesn't really create a positive for you either. So it's kind of a wash. You can still use it if you want to, mentally, if it helps you, or if you like the taste, which I've never been able to get over that taste. All right, so here's the thing. The studies that did show that there was a weight loss reduction did not look for different, did not use methodologies that looked for certain things inside of the design that could determine why weight loss was happening. Yes, one group had more fat loss than the other, but the thing with that is they didn't show they didn't look at the physiology of why that was happening. They just looked at the actual person's body fat percentage going down. They didn't pay attention to the calories that they were eating. There was ad libitum eating, which means they were able to eat whatever they like. But when this type of design is put under more rigor and they actually provide them the foods and they look at what is causing them to lose weight, they realize that the only thing that's triggering to the weight loss with apple cider vinegar is that it increases your nausea. It increases your wanting to vomit, essentially. And because that's the case, the participants that were in the group that drank apple cider vinegar would just eat less. So because the studies before weren't really looking at exactly what they were eating, they just wanted to see if fat loss was more with the apple cider vinegar group than the other groups, they couldn't really tell what was triggering it. And the trigger was the nausea. So basically what apple cider vinegar does for you, it doesn't actually burn fat. It doesn't inherently just grab some fat and burn it. Where if you didn't take apple cider vinegar, that fat burning wouldn't have taken place. It doesn't do that. It creates a feeling of nausea that just keeps you from eating more because you just lose your appetite. You're not really hungry anymore because you feel nauseous. If you've ever felt nauseous for whatever reason, it makes you not want to eat. You just don't want to eat because of that feeling of nausea. You don't like the fact that you feel that you're going to throw up your food, so you just don't eat the food. So you don't add more food on top of it. And that's what apple cider vinegar does for people. That's what the studies show. I know there's going to be a lot of apple cider vinegar people that's going to say, no way, whatever, this doesn't make any sense. I've done it, and my friend did it, and my aunt does it. But I'm just telling you what the studies of apple cider vinegars, when they go deeper in with the rigor, with the methodology, and look at the physiology of what's going on, look at why the body fat is being burned more, they see that the person or the groups of people are simply just not eating more because of the feeling of nausea. And they even give them questionnaires and tell them, hey, why didn't you eat during this time? Or why didn't you eat more? Why did you eat less than group B? And they will say, well, I was nauseous. I couldn't eat. So a lot of people use apple cider vinegar to help them when they're doing intermittent fasting. And the reason they do this is because it prevents them from eating. One cool thing you could do, it seems cruel, but if you want to, is use apple cider vinegar to get you into a flow, into a rhythm of not eating when you're doing intermittent fasting, until your body just is okay with not eating while you're doing intermittent fasting. And that happens. It just takes about 2 weeks and a half, and you can start without no tools at all. But I still recommend hydration. Water is incredibly important. Without any tools other than water, you can go ahead and not eat and not even have the desire to eat. It's not even like a lot of people who don't do intermittent fasting think it's torture. And for some people it is torture in the beginning, but once you're in that flow, ain't nobody stopping you. So they could look from the outside in and think, oh, how could you do it? How could you pass, Popeye's chicken and not want to eat it? And like, how is that even possible? Because I'm not actually even hungry. I'm not hungry. So you can use apple cider vinegar to help you get into that 2 week and a half kind of time period where your body's adjusting from not eating, from eating all the time to not eating. Or you could just use water, which kind of could help you without making you feel nauseous. Basically, the moral of the story is that with all the studies that we've had, and even the studies looking at further rigorous methodologies into apple cider vinegar, it doesn't show that there's anything inherently beneficial from the apple cider vinegar itself. The apple cider vinegar just has a certain taste and a certain reaction for you when you consume it that promotes nausea, that elicits nausea. And because of that, you tend to eat less. So some people would do it right before they're about to eat. They will take that and they'll eat either less or just not eat at all. And that's the benefit that you get from apple cider vinegar. Hopefully this video has helped you guys. And remember, it's always going to be science first, because that is the most responsible thing and the thing that can reach the most amount of people. Of course, I want to thank my patrons for my Patreon, and I'm going to go ahead and put their names right up here. And of course, as always, guys, I'll see you on Sunday for another FAQ. Peace!